Man finds Wierd cave in Montreal, enters, and drops to his knees.
But before we start, please make sure you subscribe if you haven't already. Hit the notification bell and smash that like button. We really appreciate your continuous support.
It feels like everyone waits for the day their dream house becomes theirs. However, Christopher got more than he bargained for. After exploring the new property, he'd get the biggest shock of his life. Christopher was intrigued by his new property, so he started to look around. However, he had no idea what was waiting for him inside the tunnel. He continued to explore it even when a realtor and policeman asked him to stop doing that. When he was done with his investigation, he was able to gather enough proof. He knew that the only thing he could do was leave and forget about it all. Just what exactly did he find when he started to explore his new house? No doubt he didn't expect anything of this sort at all. Christopher Wanless purchased a new place fairly recently. The property rested on 41 acres of woodland space. You can just imagine how excited he must have been to find a place to call his own. He had no idea, however, that there was some sort of portal waiting for him there. Despite this, it was what the universe planned for him. It was only inevitable that he'd take a tour of the new property and its surrounding area. Over there, the seasons were cruel and stripped away the outermost layer of trees. This might sound harsh, but it only made the area look even more beautiful. When it comes to what the area could offer, Christopher liked it all. He was fond of the silence of the woods and the bird song, and it wasn't long before he began to wander around by himself. His body and mind would go into autopilot mode, but something ended up catching his eye. What was it? As he headed for the object that captured his interest, Christopher was in a haze of some sort. It was a dark and small object that looked like it was purposefully hidden. Was it just another tree, a smaller, darker, and older one than the others? That was what he had in mind in the beginning, but he knew he could be wrong as he got closer. He was feeling excited and a little nervous as he started to inspect it. All of a sudden, Christopher fell into a 3-foot ditch. Christopher was surprised about this because the area was slightly obscured by leaves and mud. He shook him off and looked around. He couldn't believe what he was seeing. Did he really just stumble literally into an abandoned gold mine? He wasn't yet sure of it, but the structure appeared to be very old. It didn't seem like it had been touched in a while, and despite this, he felt a need to go in. The entrance to the mine had been covered in very thick moss. He couldn't see inside from there. He'd always been an adventurous guy, so he went home to get a flashlight. He couldn't wait to see what was waiting inside. Here was how Christopher described what that moment was like. When we bought the house, nobody ever told us about the fact that the estate had a lot of mines on it. We just sort of stumbled upon the gold mine one day and that was it. When I first saw it, I was so excited that I almost fell over myself. The only thing I could think about was Indiana Jones and underground railroads. When he made the decision to go inside, he didn't know it was a terrible decision on his part. Even if this was the case, he returned to the entrance with a flashlight. With this lighting device in his hand, he then walked inside. He held his breath and saw shiny objects attached to the walls. The walls looked wet and unstable, seemed like they could give way at any moment. The sounds of his footsteps just bounced off the walls. He couldn't help but wonder about the marks he left on the soil with each step he made. Christopher was eager to explore the area. As proof of that, he even brought 3 sets of spare batteries with him. He made his way towards the walls and brushed the stones that were sparkling at the wall. What if this was gold, he asked himself. He soon snapped out of it upon noticing something that made him feel concerned. This little discovery of his could truly change how the exploration would go. What was it? It might have been warm outside, but the mine was cold and even dewy on the inside. He noticed that he left deep footprints in the soil as well, so it must be wet. It meant that there must be a water source of some kind somewhere. After he took note of this, he considered it to be a huge red flag. Why? He knew that the presence of water puddles somewhere like this could mean there's a gas leak. He pointed the flashlight ahead of him and right at the end of the tunnel, but he still couldn't see where it ended. Christopher got a strong feeling that he wasn't alone down there, but he had no idea who else could possibly be there. Soon enough, his suspicions were confirmed when he heard noises that come from somewhere else in the tunnel. He let his curiosity get the better of him as he tried to figure out where the noises were coming from. He just didn't know how wrong his judgment was. He kept walking deeper and deeper into the mine. Christopher didn't find any definite sign of life. There were no noises, no footprints, nothing. He held onto his flashlight as tight as possible, almost as if it could save him from any danger. The same noises could still be heard, but it was louder this time. In his mind, the noises were very specific, like old machinery in action. He'd soon start to hear voices as well. The words weren't clear enough for Christopher to hear what they were saying, but this gave him the confidence to yell out, "Who's there?" But he didn't hear any response save for his echo. Still, he was full of courage and determination to find the speakers. All of a sudden, he saw that he was walking through water and mud. His legs sunk into the slosh each time he took another step forward. He was able to find a yellow ventilation unit, but it must have been better days in the past. He also saw chains coming from the ceiling, but they were also in bad shape. All of a sudden, Christopher could feel a terrifying energy around him. He could tell he wasn't alone down there. There was a strong feeling that overtook him, telling him he shouldn't be there. He, however, ignored all of this and kept walking to follow the path of the water. He felt convinced it was going to lead him to whatever or whomever was making all the noise. Could someone have been living there all this time? The ambient temperature also seemed to suddenly drop all around me at this point, and I felt an even stronger negative presence ahead in the tunnel, he explained. It was only 100 feet into the tunnel, and he saw light in the distance. What could it be? He was in shock when he finally figured it out. He was in complete disbelief, but his body eventually caught up with his brain. It told him to move out of the way, and he did. After noticing one of the chains start to move by itself, he jumped and clung to the wall for his life. The chain wasn't only swaying from a gust of wind. No, there must have been someone there because the chain was moving with so much force. He turned around and heading back to the entrance as soon as he could. His heart was pounding, as was his head by the time he got outside. He needed to talk to someone about what he just found, but who could he possibly tell? He let himself catch his breath and then made a beeline for his house. Christopher figured out who he had to call before anyone else, his real estate agent. In detail, he explained what he just went through in a small but scary tunnel. The realtor said they'd have someone come over to take a look at it as soon as possible. When we went to ask about the place, we were finally told that the estate had actually been home to quite a lot of mining sites. A lot of mining was done in these hills at the turn of the century, and there are actually a lot of little mines that are scattered across the hills, Christopher shared. At first, he was overcome with a feeling of relief. However, he immediately started to feel more tense as his entire body tightened up and made breathing difficult. He yelled, "This can't be happening." Christopher was motionless in the kitchen after hanging up the telephone. Out of the blue, the lights in the house began to flicker on and off. He did his best to stay calm and told himself there was nothing bad happening, but he couldn't help but panic when everything went dark all of a sudden. He was able to locate the switch despite the darkness. He tried flipping it on and off, but that didn't stop what was going on. Christopher also began to feel a breeze inside the room he was sure wasn't there a moment ago. After everything he went through, he knew it wasn't a good idea to remain in the dark, so he grabbed the flashlight and used it to shine on the thermostat. He was able to tell the temperature drastically went down in only a matter of seconds. It was started to get so cold in the house he was unable to see his breath. He thought, how strange, but there was no way he could sit in the dark the entire night, so he went to the circuit box. He used the flashlight to check the circuit breaker. Didn't seem like there was a problem. He tried changing the settings by flipping different switches. He wasn't a professional, however, so he knew it wasn't a problem he could fix by himself. It was a good thing this seemed to be the case. The power eventually returned without any more crazy and inexplicable events. Faulty wiring, Christopher told himself as he tried to calm himself down. Christopher said there was nothing to be worried about. It was perfectly safe, right? He went upstairs and fetched a glass of water from the kitchen in an effort to remain his composure. Can you imagine his reaction when the doorbell rang all of a sudden? What could it be this time? Christopher opened the door and found a man who introduced himself as Mr. Rudolph there. He told the homeowner he was sent by the real estate agency after the phone call and wanted to learn more about what he discovered on the property. He asked Christopher to lead him to the mine so he could find out what was going on. Together, the two of them walked through the woods to reach the mine. At the time, the sky was a dark shade of gray and it looked like a big storm was on the way. Christopher led Mr. Rudolph to the mine entrance but warned him he had to be careful down there to avoid any danger. When they got there, the two of them brought out their flashlights in the name of extra precaution. That time, the sparkles on the walls appeared to be even shinier. The material nearly blinded them by just looking at it. Mr. Rudolph inspected the walls very closely, much in the same way a child would on Christmas Day. He turned back to look to Christopher, but the look on his face had bad news. Mr. Rudolph informed Christopher that they were certainly standing inside a gold mine right at that moment. He could hardly keep his eyes off the shiny walls. Both of them knew that the gold there was untouched. It was so easy to tell the miners who'd been working there ended up abandoning the site instead of finishing the project. But why would they do something like that anyway? Mr. Rudolph was aware of all the rumors that surrounded the abandoned gold mines from the beginning of the century, but he had no idea if they were reliable. Before this one, he'd never been inside a gold mine. Christopher couldn't come up with an explanation about why it was abandoned halfway through the project, but he was intrigued to find out the history behind the tunnel. Christopher somehow found the courage to go deep inside the mine once more. There was this feeling he'd discover gold for himself. If not that, he'd at least find out how haunted his mine was. He dove inside the gold mine yet again, still armed with his flashlight and lots of extra batteries in a tote bag. As he got deeper into the cave, all he could see was darkness. The first time he went inside the tunnel, he was only able to make it 150 feet before he decided it was time to head out. This time, he had the determination to see it to the end regardless of how scared he might be. This was the only way he'd ever find the answers he wanted. At 600 feet inside the tunnel, he finally found out where all the water came from. He found a single door ahead of him. Goosebumps filled every last inch of his body. There was also water falling on his face now. Christopher took a deep breath and brought up his hand with the intention of knocking. Of course, he hoped that there would be no one behind the door. Upon opening it, he was shocked by the discovery he made. It was like he just walked into an alternate universe of some sort. The weather outside was warm and nice, but this room was just as cold as the inside of a freezer. He touched the walls only to find them cold to the touch. Down there, they also felt much rougher and more unfinished than those on the outside. His claustrophobia was finally kicking in, telling him it was time to turn around and head outside. It was then that the flashlight caught something that captured his attention. He stared at a pile of random items inside the room, but nothing about it made a lick of sense. Why would anyone leave all their stuff in such a random and secluded place? However, he was also starting to find it harder to breathe down there. He was able to notice that breathing was starting to become difficult. Clearly, there was something off about the whole thing, but what was it? After taking a close look at all the things down there, he saw that it was actually a rusted bed spring and a ruined mattress. That gave him all the answers he'd been looking for. Clearly, someone had been living there without any intention of leaving soon. Christopher stood there, staring at the bed for some time until something more intriguing caught the attention. What could it be this time? Yes, it seemed like he found a concrete hideout down there. Didn't make him feel any better. What kind of person would need a hiding place like this when the room was already obscured by an intriguing door? The person who made this must have been trying to hide something big. He went up to the opening but failed to see anything from there. As he turned around to leave, something on the wall caught his eye. He shone the flashlight on the bricks and saw white scribbles on the surface. He was unable to figure out what they said until he took a closer look. What he found was bizarre and rendered him at a loss. There were four vertical lines on the wall. Using his hands, he touched the scratch marks to see what they were like. He could tell someone made them using fingernails. They weren't deep enough to have been made using a sharp object, but they were deep enough to leave a mark on the cement. He had no clue who could have been trapped in there, but he only got more terrified the more he thought about these things. There were other scratches on the wall as well. This time, the marks formed letters. He was aware the letters made up a word together, but couldn't figure out what they said. He brought out his camera to take a photo. Christopher was hoping he'd decode it using his computer. He'd been in dead silence the whole time, so you can imagine just how terrified he was after hearing a loud noise. He knew there must be someone else in that room. He brought out the flashlight and pointed at the direction of the noise, but he couldn't find anything there. He tried to inspect the writings on the wall some more until he heard the sound of banging metal. Not only that, but he felt a cold breeze on the back of his neck. It felt like he'd just gotten in an ice bath. In a matter of seconds, all the warmth he possessed was gone. Christopher could only feel the freezing cold. In the beginning, he assumed the breeze came from behind him. He knew this wasn't the case when he felt it in front of him and on his sides as well. He didn't know where it came from and why, but he was scared for his life. He started to run. Christopher got goosebumps once more and had a horrible feeling go through his entire body. He was aware something wasn't right about the situation. His brain told him to stay still and silent, but his body told him something else. This was how he ended up sprinting out of that mine in record time. He ended up collapsing on the floor as soon as he made it out. He was that scared. If you ask us, the first clue that there was something weird going on was the gold mine was untouched. It was just too good to be true. Well, he did end up learning this in the end. It turned out there were stories about this place he didn't know beforehand. Catching his breath, he went home. Everything outside had been as still as possibly can be, and Christopher found it eerie. For some reason, it seemed like the environment was reflecting the terror he felt in that moment. He had a hard time focusing on anything. The only thing on his mind was that he had to return to the safety of his house. After he made it back to the house at long last, he went to his study and made sure to lock the door. He was aware there was something shady happening in the mine. Christopher wanted to get to the bottom of things no matter what it took. He eventually tried to look for answers on the internet. After he tried to look up haunted mines on Google, he got goosebumps as the results loaded again. He could tell the presence he felt in the mine was now inside the house. Christopher wasn't sure if this was just his mind playing wicked tricks on him. Christopher turned around and started to hear whispers right behind where he was. Could he be going insane? Was any of this real? He turned around once more and the whispers stopped at once, but the air remained icy. The only thing he could hear right then was his heavy breathing. The results page finally finished loading. The first said, if you want to get rid of the paranormal activity in the mine and subsequently in your life, you have to face it. Could Christopher actually do this? There was nothing he could do but give it a shot. It was then that he heard someone knocking in series of threes. Christopher felt a lump in his throat and swallowed. He was able to croak out, "Hello." After that, he took a few steps forward and turned the door handle. When he returned to the kitchen, he noticed a whirring noise of some sort. It came from his camera. Why was his camera making a noise like that? It wasn't even on. As you can see, things were starting to get weirder. Christopher picked it up. He was sure he turned it off as soon as he returned to the house, but even so, he found it on. He checked the photos he took inside the mine, but something weird started happening. He didn't find a single photo on the SD card. It had been wiped. He took the device and headed for the mine. He knew the only thing to do was to face whatever was in there. Enough was enough. He managed to gather the courage he needed to go down the tunnel once more. Again, darkness was the only thing Christopher could see. He realized the error of his ways as soon as his eyes adjusted to the dark. What was he doing down there? The dark tunnel looked even darker than usual. Was it this dark tunnel the first two times he ventured inside? He assumed maybe this had something to do with the power of his flashlight. He continued walking. He walked in the muck but stopped when a gust of wind hit him. The force was so strong that it was comparable to something solid getting thrown at him. He could feel the cold right down to his bones. At that moment, Christopher heard a familiar sound. It was the metal noise he heard before. What was going on? It might have been scary, but he just kept walking. This was actually a lapse of judgment. He continued to walk the length of that dark tunnel. All of a sudden, he stopped. The noise was beginning to sound like it was too close to him. His ears started ringing and he even yelped in pain. By then, it was already too far for him to back out. The metal noise was like a barrage of various metal objects clunking together. Christopher cupped his head in his palms for some time. All of a sudden, the noise stopped. As soon as that happened, he felt scared and looked up. The silence was even creepier than the noise, and it was then that he saw something. There were chains hanging from the roof of that corridor. They began to swing so rhythmically that you think they were all dancing. He felt so hypnotized by the sight that he couldn't process the sudden sound of water. His eyes adjusted at last, and then he saw that a huge tidal wave was coming for him. It looked like a tsunami. "I must be going crazy," he said, when the silence was interrupted by the sound of water. He could feel a headache coming on. His entire body started to scream as well as he tried to get out of there as quickly as he could. What was Christopher planning to do after this? It didn't look like he could deal with the thing in the mine on his own. As he made his way out of there, he took one last glance back. He was perplexed when he noticed that there was no trace of water. No, the only thing Christopher saw was the footsteps he left in the mud. He started the trek from the mine back home. He was aware it was time to ask for help with this mystery. Not knowing what was happening was driving him insane, and it would happen to us too if we found something like this on our property. As Christopher made his way through the forest, he halted when he saw a light of some sort. It came from his very own kitchen window. He couldn't remember if the lights were on or not by the time he left. He felt certain it had been off. Could someone be in the house? He entered his home, but he sensed the house was empty. Didn't look like there was anyone else in there. Maybe he really did leave the lights on. He went to the kitchen, but his mind was still on the mystery of the mine. Christopher continued to ask himself if that truly happened. He returned to the study and booted his computer up. He wondered, could he actually do this? Even though he wasn't the sort of person who believes in the supernatural, he was starting to wonder if he was wrong about that. Once more, he turned on the search engine and started typing a question. The computer let out a noise before the screen turned black. Did it just shut down on its own? What could possibly go wrong next, Christopher wondered. He had no idea this wasn't the end of it yet at all. By then, he was exhausted both in the mental and physical sense. He was worn down after everything. He put his head in his hands and felt a pull. What could be tugging at his feet now? Christopher stumbled backward and fell as he did so. It was the last straw. The only thing he could do was leave and get help. Perhaps there was a rational explanation behind it all. He got into his car and sought sanctuary at the nearest cafe he could find. After walking through the doors, he got a double espresso and used his phone to get internet access. He searched "best paranologist near me" and was surprised to see two places near his current location. Once more, he hopped into his car and made his way to one of them. On the storefront hung some kind of sign that said tarot readings. The sight of this immediately comforted Christopher, despite the fact that he still had quite a hard time believing what he just discovered in the tunnel. No matter what, he knew he needed to do this. He needed to get the answers to his questions, especially if he wanted to get a good night's sleep. As he entered the door and walked into the store, there was a real strong smell of incense, and right in front of him was a woman. She was fully clothed in purple and red, and as she got closer to Christopher, she put her hand out and immediately started reciting some kind of chant, which, weirdly enough, sounded familiar. The song drew him in, and he realized it was the same chant he heard while in the mine. However, this one sounded more melodic. As soon as he realized this, he dashed straight for his car. Without even thinking, Christopher drove straight to his mother's house, and in no time, he put the house up for sale. The developers, who soon became responsible for the property, tried to get in touch with him, but he never contacted them. His mother was the one who did everything on his behalf and made sure the property was sold. She was, of course, open to any negotiations, just as long as someone would open the property. Now, there are still many unanswered questions about the whole story. Did everything Christopher claimed to see really happen? Was the mine truly haunted, or was his mind just playing tricks? Has anyone else ever embarked down the mine to see what's down there? Undoubtedly, we don't have the answers to the questions. But wait until you see more stories from us that are bizarre, mysterious, and intriguing.